I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me. I'm told this is a once-in-a-lifetime honor to give a talk here. I'm getting very old, but in the next birth, I will not remember that I gave this talk already. Okay. So I'm going to talk about two apparently different kinds of problems, and then it came to my mind that they're actually duals of each other. So that's the main theme of the problem. So super resolution is related to what I'm going to call component separation problem. It has it looks like this. We have such a sum for different points x sub m, and then we have this kind of information for a certain number of finitely many j's, and then we are supposed to determine the number of components here and where the support is and what the weights are. And this is a very old problem. It appears already in the book of Lanthus on Applied Mathematics under the name of Hidden Periodicities. It's also called Direction Finding in Phased Array Antennas. There are a lot of papers by Krim and even a book by Pillai. Then it's called Singularity Detection, in which there are many people here who have worked. Also, Professor Todd Moore here at Maryland has worked on this. Then it's also called parameter estimation and blind source signal separation more recently. and I think you heard some talks by both Haotian Wu and Charles Chui a couple of years ago on this problem. So super resolution means the question is how many pieces of information do you need here? And then the general wisdom is that if you look at the minimal separation here, then the number n which I had before about the number of amount of information, it should be greater than some constant times the reciprocal of the minimal separation. So then David Donahoe and Candace and Fernandez Granda, three generations of mathematicians, asked, can we do this problem when the number of information we have is much less than this reciprocal of minimal separation? So that's called a super resolution problem. Okay, so I want to do a little bit more in this direction, and one of my colleagues proposed that I should call it super duper resolution because I don't know what other name to give it. So the idea is that I think of this as a certain measure, and then these quantities which were given to us were the trigonometric moments of this measure. And now the question becomes like this, that I know the trigonometric moments of a certain measure plus some noise, and I want to determine what this measure is. So this is probably a hard problem from the previous point of view, because now there is no minimal separation. The measure can be, for example, absolutely continuous on the circle, and the minimal separation is zero. And therefore, any solution which is based on finite amount of information is going to be beyond super resolution. In particular, we cannot solve this problem exactly given finite amount of information. But one advantage of doing it like this is that the problem can be generalized to a lot more general settings. For example, when mu star is supported on some locally compact space or something like that. A variation of this problem is we are given a certain kernel G, and we are looking at the convolution of G with this mu star. Mathematically, this is equivalent because you just have to take the Fourier transform and divide by the Fourier coefficients of G. Okay. Then the other component of my talk is machine learning. And I'm glad Professor Pojo is here because I learned this from him. I think the state of the art has, of course, changed a lot since then. But still, the fundamental problems are probably still the same. So we have IID samples from some unknown probability distribution. And we have a certain target function here, which is the conditional expectation of y given x. We have a certain marginal distribution for x. And this x is the support of this measure. There are two kinds of problems which appear in machine learning. We are either interested in figuring out what is this tau and tau star, or otherwise we are interested in figuring out what is the target function. So this is the probability estimation problem. This is the function approximation problem. OK, so in function approximation, that's what I'm mostly familiar with. One of the typical assumptions which happens is that we are given a kernel G, and we can observe the values of such a function. And our target function has such a form. This sort of assumption is made in many papers, most recently by Klosowski and Baron, but also in the previous decade by Kurkova and Sanguinetti and so on. By the way, this is a class of functions for which the class curse of dimensionality does not apply, because we can use Hoeffding's inequality and get dimension independent bounds for this sort of kernel approximation. And Kurkova and so on have called this total variation of mu star to be the G variation of F. Okay, so once more, finding this F is equivalent to finding this mu star, because the kernel is known. And finding mu star is what I have called super-duper resolution. On the other hand, if we are given a samples from the probability measure, then we can choose this kernel G. And then the laws of large numbers gives me approximately what this mu star is. OK, so there is a single solution to both of these problems in my mind. For last several decades, I'm interested in making localized kernels out of algebraic polynomials and trigonometric polynomials and all kinds of global objects. So like a village idiot, I'm proposing the same solution to every problem that I come across. So I'm going to take some kind of an approximate identity. And if I can build an approximate identity, then this is, of course, going to approximate this mu star in the weak star sense. And then I can estimate this integral using the Monte Carlo method and keep track of all the errors by things like Hoeffding's inequality. For function approximation, I have to construct this approximate identity from this kernel G. And then if I do it like this, then again, the formal equation is the same as this, except that now it is approximating it in the soup norm. So there is a kind of duality here. In this kind of problem, we are given values of x. In this kind of problem, we are given values on y, namely the samples of mu star. So they are the same things. If we solve one, then we have solved the other. And then there is a reality check. I asked a young postdoc called Dima Batinkov to try this for me. So we are talking about the sphere now as my space. The corresponding orthonormalized system is denoted by P sub L. And this is my localized kernel. So the filter looks like this. It's 1 up to half, and then decreases smoothly to 0. And here is a localization of the kernel. If x is equal to y, then t is 1. So you see that this is log scale. At t equal to 1, this is a normalized to be 1. But very fast, it is decreasing to 1/100th of this strength. So it's highly localized kernel. And then, as I said, I asked Dr. Batinkov to try a toy example for me. So he took 10 random points on the sphere. This is in the latitude-longitude graph. And then this was the measure which we are trying to detect given Fourier moments with respect to the spherical harmonics. And this is the result which I got using this localized kernel. So you see that the locations are more or less exactly detected. And then the coefficients were also approximately detected, but not so well. So we are still working on such problems on how to improve upon this part here. Okay, so it works, at least in some toy examples. And so the next topic will be to come back to machine learning and talk about the same problem under probability estimation point of view. So now we are not given samples of integral of g of x, y. We are given samples from a probability distribution. And the idea is to estimate that probability distribution. Okay, so the motivation behind this problem is the famous Belkin-Nyogi theorem. It says that if you have a smooth and compact submanifold of a high dimensional space, and mu star is the Riemannian volume measure normalized to be 1, and this is the Laplace-Beltrami operator, then this object converges to the Laplacian. I like to use Q for the dimension because not very many words I can think of start with Q. This is the foundation of the entire area of harmonic analysis called diffusion geometry techniques. But when I looked at this theorem, it looks more like a negative theorem to me. It's like a saturation theorem. You take this T to the other side, and this tells me that if you want to use the Gaussian to approximate this function, then there is a saturation. No matter how smooth this F is, you cannot do anything better than T times the Laplacian. So the rate cannot be improved more than T. Okay. There is an ancient paradigm for this called Voronovskaya theorem, and I would like you to buy my book. Whether or not you are interested in this, the royalty income from this goes to charities in India. So the children of India will thank you, and not just the two of us. I always wanted to say that here is a saturation theorem. Can I do something better? And the saturation comes from two sources. One is that the Gaussian is a positive kernel. And it is very well known that positive kernels just do not give a good approximation. And the other saturation is coming from the curvature of the manifold. Okay, the curvature is there. There is nothing I can do about it. But maybe I can remove this positivity somehow and get something so that, let's say, if I have a subspace of a lower dimension, then I can do a substantially better. There should be no limitation on how well I can approximate the function. Okay, so this is my solution to this problem. I look at orthonormalized Hermite functions. This object is a polynomial multiplied by, that's okay. This is a polynomial of degree k multiplied by e to the minus x squared over 2. If I want to go to multiple dimensions, then I just take the tensor product. I don't want to complicate the notation here by mentioning the q, but it suffices to say that it's an orthonormal system. I will complicate the notation here. This is the projection on total degree m polynomials. But this q means that I'm looking at q dimensional tensor products. Remember that there are two q's here. One is the capital Q, which is the ambient dimension space, and little q is the space of the manifold. So there is a cute identity called Mailer formula, which is fascinating for me very much. And it states like this. You don't have to compute this tensor product Hermite polynomials here. You can calculate this using just the dot product between x and y and the norm expressions here. And then the dimension appears only in this factor. So if I multiply it by such a factor and I know how to compute the Taylor expansion, there is no loss in generality in assuming that q minus q is an even number, because otherwise I can just add a zero to the ambient space representation. And then this is a finite mask. And then I do this thing which is called Njordlund means in the book of Hardy from 1941. So such a very ancient object helps. So then I consider my localized operator in this way. And I proved a Tauberian theorem a few years ago, which tells me because of the Mailer identity that this object has this property. And the interesting part here is that the dependence on the dimensionality is not on the ambient space, but on the dimension of the submanifold. Okay. So this very ancient Norlund means of Hermite polynomials helps me to get around this question of Belkin-Nyogi. And then the theorem I can prove is like this, that this is the same setting as in the Belkin-Nyogi theorem. Because of the curvature, I have to assume that this gamma is less than 1. Sufficiently smooth, we'll have to have a technical description in terms of the tangent planes and so on. But this gamma represents the smoothness of F. And then the result is that I can directly approximate this F on the manifold according to this rate. Okay. No need to compute the Laplacian, no need to compute eigenfunctions or anything like that. Here is a very direct approximation to F. And if I'm talking about a subspace, then I don't need this assumption. There is no saturation which was there in the Belkin-Nyogi theorem. Okay, so this is a theoretical result. I'm still looking for young people who will be sufficiently interested in trying this out. And I was lucky enough to find at least a couple of people who are interested. So the next part of the talk will advertise what they have done. So here is one application which together with Alex Kloninger and Xu Cheng from Duke University. Alex Kloninger, I think you know very well. He was at University of Maryland and now he's in UC San Diego. So we wanted to build a discriminative model. We have a data here and we are looking at a classical classification problem. So we are looking at the probability that if we are given an X, then the Y has the class K. There is something called one hot classification. So for any label K, we are going to do a yes or no experiment. The output will be 1 if it has label K and -1 otherwise. We will estimate this probability and then find out which is the largest probability. Okay, the thing is, this X is now everywhere in this R to the Q. And so it could happen that the X does not have a label. And it could be that there could be more than one label for any X. So these are the problems which we want to figure out. Does this X have a label? And can it have more than one label? Then which one should we pick? So we define what is called a witness function. So once more, the marginal distribution of xj is mu star. A witness function is this. Oh, I'm sorry, this is not a two-variable thing now. It's just one-variable function. It's 1 if x is label 1 and -1 is label -1 and 0 if x doesn't have a label. And then a discriminative network is a network G with this property. By the way, I'm going to talk about Hermite polynomials, but because of the Mailer identity, the Hermite polynomial can be implemented as a Gaussian network exponentially rapidly. So whether I talk about network or Hermite polynomials, they are one and the same thing. Okay, so here are some simplifications. We are not talking in this paper about subspaces and submanifolds. We will just assume the whole thing. Which in practical term means that we have to do feature selection separately. Okay, so we will assume that the right features are selected so that we are directly working in the latent space of the problem. And we are going to assume that then in this latent space our probability distribution is absolutely continuous. And then we have then let's assume that the feature spaces are selected properly so that the classes are sufficiently well separated. And if they are well separated, then at least in theory, we can assume that there is a function 1 if it is reliably in class here, and F2 is 1 if it is reliably in this other class. And then I'm looking at this difference. If this difference is small, then it means one of the two things. Either the label is not certain, or otherwise it is doesn't have a label. But okay, so we will construct such a witness function using this Hermite kernel, which I just showed you. And then we will use a statistical test called permutation test, which has a certain level A for confidence. And then if this object exceeds this threshold A, then we will say that now this thing is large or small reliably to classify this X properly. If it does not exceed this, then it means that we don't know what's going on. X may not have a label to begin with, or it could be very uncertain. So here is a data set which we looked at. CIFAR-10 is a data set. We have color images in 10 classes. We have 50,000 training data points and 10,000 test data points. Alex decided to choose the features from the last hidden layer of this VGG16 network with 512 neurons at the last but one layer. So the outputs of these things are going to be our features. The error rate for this network itself is 6%. And the goal is that we know the features now. Can we then build the witness function so that before we go to the last layer, we can find out why the test error is 6%? Can we lower it? So why would the test error be 6% instead of 0? Because there are some bad apples in the test data. If we can remove those bad apples before actually classifying them, then we should be able to improve the performance of this network tremendously. That's the hope. So we don't want to know the ground truth. We just want to use our witness function and remove the bad apples. And it worked very nicely. So we can reduce the error up to about 1%, in fact, by increasing this level of confidence. And then it turns out that we are omitting about 800 to 1,000 of the test data. So there were not that many bad apples. The bad error was happening because of this small number of bad apples. Okay. So it seems to me that this is a nice thing. I liked it very much. And when we like something, then we want to repeat it. So so now we come to learning with small number of labels. So then the question is, when we learn calculus, then the teacher does not solve every problem in the book. He solves probably a few problems. And then when the students ask more problems, then he will solve more problems. So can we imitate this also with deep learning? Or recurrent learning. So this is a joint work in progress with our postdoc Select Sitnik, and maybe Alex if he's interested. So the idea is that we start with a small amount of training data, and then we use the witness function to see which points in the remaining data are going to be bad apples. Then we add those bad apples to the training data and repeat this process. Then either the data is exhausted or we are, in the sense that we get tired and now I need a picture to show in a lecture, then let's stop this experiment and produce whatever we have. Okay. And then he used this idea with the MNIST data. The MNIST data is a slightly simpler version of CIFAR-10, where we have 10 digits handwritten. And there are again 10 classes and again 50,000 training points and 10,000 test points. And he got so far 91% accuracy using just 2,569 labeled data points by using this recurrent network approach based on witness function. Okay. Then again, there is a harder super resolution problem, which was posed by Mauro Maggioni, also in Maryland, and his postdoc called Murphy, whom I don't know. So the problem is like this. Please remember that in the super resolution problem, we had a linear combination of the Dirac deltas. We want to use something more general than the Dirac delta. So we have some probability distributions mu sub j, and we take a convex combination, but we don't know how many are there, and we don't know what they are and what these combinations are. And then can we separate this? Okay, in this work by Maggioni and Murphy, they assumed a certain minimal separation among the supports of mu sub j. And then they used the idea of diffusion distance to somehow separate out these mu sub j and w sub j. Okay, so we want to do a harder super duper resolution problem. And the question is then, can we assume no minimal separation? So now we don't want to assume that the mu sub j's are separated by some distance. Please remember that in the machine learning problems, the classes are not always well separated. They're bound to be, it's not a reasonable assumption to say that the mu sub j's are well separated. So can we do it without it? Okay, there is a small problem. When we remove this assumption of minimal separation, the problem doesn't make sense. So here is an example why it doesn't make sense. So here are just 5 points. We can imagine, of course, that all these 5 points are coming from the same distribution. Yes? Oh, okay, that should be enough. Yeah. But you see that depending upon the eyes of the beholder, there are various ways of clustering this. This is one cluster, this is another, and this is by itself. Or you can say that this is one cluster and this is another cluster. So at different levels, there are different clusters. Okay, so the idea is that we have a positive definite matrix, just like in diffusion geometry. And then these are our features for the vectors x and y. And then I want to compute not phi sub n of little x and little y, but phi sub n of capital X and capital Y. The beauty of the whole Mailer identity is that in order to compute this kernel, I just need the dot products between x and y. The dot product between x and y is just k of xy. So I can just calculate phi sub n xy without having to do this eigen decomposition by using k of xy instead of this. And once more, if k is a Gaussian similarity matrix, which is common in diffusion geometry, the phi sub n is a Hermit polynomial. As I mentioned, Hermit polynomial is almost like a Gaussian network. So this is a two hidden layer Gaussian network. Okay, so then the question, of course, is why? And so we decided to explore why. And so we picked a distribution here and another distribution here and another distribution here. And when we just calculate the Hermite kernel, then based on this k of xy, as I told you, it looks like this. Okay. So again, there are lots of kernels. It depends upon how significant I want it to be. If I truncate this kernel with a very small threshold, then I see only one cluster here. If I begin to increase the threshold level, then there are smaller and smaller clusters. So three clusters appear. And if I increase it too much, then there is again just one cluster with high probability. Okay, so when we have such things, then we ask for labels at these three things. And when we have the labels, then again we play the same game and try to classify this. So at one level, this is the class which we got. After we decreased the confidence levels, then we started increasing the number of points in the support. We just extend the label by taking the connected component of this graph structure. And in the end, we get these labels. The bad apples here are now these 4 or 5 points which are left over. So this picture was obtained by just three labels. It tells me where the bad apples are. Once I get the labels for those bad apples, then I have 100% accuracy. with very small number of labels. Okay, so thank you.